What is it about that type of work that you find particularly interesting as a collector?
Well, I remember my first art history class in college, and it was really a changing moment in my life when my teacher, Beau Davis, put up a slide of Monet's work, and it was Olympia. And he started to talk about the different meanings, the symbolic meaning of the cat and the woman with the flowers and the pose of the way the woman's looking out at you. And it really changed my life because to that moment, I had no idea why I was involved with art. It was just something where I could make illusions, create depth, and do these different things, but I had no idea what the power of art was till that moment. And then I realized I could be in a dialogue, I could be involved with philosophy, psychology, sociology, aesthetics, physics, I mean, all the areas that I hope that you can see a little bit that my work kind of tries to make reference to. But that I had all these areas of play to be involved with the community, to really be engaged. And so it was life changing for me. That's what I like about art history. I feel that, you know, it's interacting with these people. I'm a different person since I came across Manet's work. I think my genes are different, I think. And I'm a different human being.
And is it when you come home and you look at these works like you're transported to a different time?
Yes, and they're different. You know, you relate to what it was like to be alive at that time, think about their lives, sensitivity to their life, but it also just gives you a sense of your own potential. I feel stronger. It's kind of like inviting the kind of the gods into your body in a way, and it's whatever's being, you know, coming from that work that you're looking at.
So if you think of Monet, Manet, 100, 200 years ago, what do you want the world to think about Jeff Koons in 200 years? How would you like your legacy to be shown also? Would you want your work to be at a museum? Would you want to have the equivalent of a Rothko chapel? Would you want to have a Koons museum? I mean, you think about what you'd like your legacy to be really 100 plus years from now.
I would say the first part of my legacy would be my children, that you know, they're happy people and that they're productive within their community, and you know, that I've been a good parent and try to create a lot of opportunity for them. Then after that, I would say as an artist, I hope that I represent, I want to be the best artist I can possibly be. I want to exercise the freedom that we all have in life, but to exercise that freedom that we have to make gesture. I mean, we can reach a level of consciousness if we just open ourselves up to that ability to make those gestures. I mean, it feels like all the freedom that we have is just paralleling us right now. I don't want on my deathbed to be there that all of a sudden that clarity comes right at that moment. And it's like, oh, you know, why didn't I do it? You know, it would have been so easy. It was right there the whole time. Why didn't I just realize I was so free? I could have just done that. I could have done it. You know, I want to achieve that now. And so,
But does part of that involve having your work in museums? Is that something that's important to you?
I think it involves having people have the opportunity to interact with the work. Because, you know, just to make it for yourself, that's one thing, but you want to share that experience with other people. So museums are functioning in a way to help educate people, create a platform that they can see art, experience it. But just as we talked about public art places, and what you want is just that people understand their possibilities. Alexander Calder's grandfather did that for me with that sculpture of William Penn. And you know, I just want to affect people's minds.
It's an interesting point because I think, you know, collectors often think, what should they do with their collection? Should they give it to a museum? Should they sell it at auction? And it is a struggle because often, 99% of the time, if you give it to a museum, it's going to be in the basement more than it's going to be on display. Whereas, you know, selling it to another collector to enjoy is more likely going to be viewed and enjoyed more. So, you know, I know artists feel differently at different points in time about how much work they want to see in a museum and how museums can manage it. You've been lucky that you have a lot of collectors that have their own museums, so they can show your work much more frequently. And obviously the road you must
turned out and how your work looks in that museum?
Well, I think the Broad's fantastic. I think for, you know, my generation, it's an amazing collection of work, and it's beautiful, the lighting, and so I think it's an amazing collection. I'm very, very proud to participate in it. As far as when I come home, I don't come home to any of my works. You know, I'm around my works all day long, and I love being there, and that's a place that I'm probably happier than that, just being in the studio. But when I come home, another reason I collect is so that my children, when they think about art, they don't think of their father. My wife, Justine's also an artist, so that they don't think about her either. They think of us as mom and dad. And when they think about art, they think about these other people. You know, they'll think about, you know, the works we enjoy to be around. They'll think about, you know, some of these names are great names, Matinee and Picasso and Dali and Magritte. But that's what they think about art. So they have so much more possibility, I think, as individuals to be involved in the arts, the fine arts, much more freedom.
Are any of your kids showing signs of having an interest in being an artist?
I think they all do. I mean, they all love to draw, from my youngest, Mickey, to my oldest, Sean. They all love it. So I think it creates a lot of freedom.
It's good to be able to be, usually people have to choose, or not choose, but they take a path of being more of an artist or a collector. You've been lucky that you can be an artist and a collector.
Yes, and you know, people, I mean, I think we collect in all different ways. There are different, you know, collecting postcards, or, you know, there's so many areas in life, but, you know, art is something that I enjoy, and I understand, I really believe in its value, and you know, its value is that it changes your life. One of the first major pieces that I acquired was a Picasso Kiss from 1969, and it really helped me feel free again. I started to feel a loss of freedom following kind of Duchampian ideas, and it was so removed from kind of intuitive thought that all of a sudden, you know, getting involved in Picasso's work and seeing how everything goes full circle, and through intuitive thought, it becomes so layered. One thought on top of another, it just goes full circle into the realm of the objective. And it just brought so much freedom back into my life. And, you know, I can look at that painting, and I can look at it and see Picasso referencing Titian, and referencing all the different aspects, sexual conquests, and also artistic conquests in his life, and just layer upon layer that's referenced.
I mean, Picasso world.